I used to be an anti-Semite, an anti-Israel activist, and believed that the only way for true peace to be achieved would be the annihilation of the State of Israel and the annihilation of Jews worldwide. I always get a much better reaction in Tehran, that one, I don't know, US audiences. But honestly, that's what I used to believe, sincerely. What's important, I guess, for you guys as an audience when I speak is the fact that I'm British. I was born in Britain, I lived my whole life in Britain, and my radicalization took place in Britain. And thankfully my views changed, or this obviously would be very awkward. So to explain how I became radicalized and what eventually changed, I need to explain a bit about my background. My grandparents, they emigrated to the UK from Pakistan in the late 60s, early 70s. Very conventional immigrant story. You know, better economic opportunities, better opportunities for their children, so on and so forth. You know, they wanted to live in a freer society, which Great Britain offered them compared to Pakistan at the time. Not that it's got any better. But so it was very conventional. And they moved to Nottingham, and they lived in an area of Nottingham which to this day is predominantly Muslim. You know, many immigrants from Pakistan have come and settled there. Like, it's very common. They were very observant, and still are very observant, devout Sunni Muslims, but weren't radical. By the scale of radicalism you have today, and this isn't one of those, the Muslims are coming, run, kind of thing. You know, because most Muslims are fairly conventional like anyone else. You know, they want to see the Jets or the Giants win the Super Bowl. Good luck. And, you know, want the best for their kids. You really shouldn't say that in New York, should I? But, you know, very conventional kind of hopes and dreams. So the one thing about the community and my grandparents and family in general, there was this one issue which would elicit a lot of hatred, a lot of aggression, a lot of anger, would be Israel and the Jews. Whenever Israel was mentioned, whenever Jews were mentioned, they would become quite hostile. And bear in mind, to this day, they've never spoken to an Israeli or anyone Jewish. Living in Britain since the 70s, they've never spoken to anyone Israeli or Jewish. But there was this hostility. And, you know, if Israel was mentioned, you'd have, well, you know, you can't really trust the Jews. You know, the Jews run America. You know, the Jews control the UN. If only, so it makes things so much easier. And so on and so forth. All these really strange stereotypes, and some would go a lot further. My father was much more on the extreme side of the spectrum. He would frequently say that Hitler was a great man, and Hitler's one mistake was that he didn't kill enough Jews. 6 million wasn't a big enough number for him. Not a great message to be growing up around when you're 6 or 7, but at 6 or 7, it's not really my priority. You know, my priority was the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles and trying to figure out who my favorite was. Michelangelo, if anyone's interested. But the community in Nottingham, like I say, Israel and anti-Semitism was an issue. And unfortunately, it's an issue in many Muslim communities, extreme or moderate. It's unfortunately a real ingrained issue. But other than that, there wasn't the stream of radicalism you're now seeing developing all over the world. But the community did become radical, and it happened at a really rapid pace. And the catalyst for that was the publication of a book which caused huge anger throughout the world, especially the Muslim world, but throughout even Muslim communities in the West. And that book was Salman Rushdie's Satanic Verses. Now, has anyone read Satanic Verses? It's boring, isn't it? It really is one of the boringest books. I was ready to go after Rushdie once I read it, you know? It's like, dude, you've wasted like 3 months of my life. No, not really, I'm saying this on camera. No, I have nothing against the author or the publishers. That wasn't the issue, of course, for the Muslim community. For the Muslim community, Satanic Verses was judged to be offensive to the Prophet Muhammad and offensive to Islam. Now, this was something new, because for Muslims who had come from Pakistan or from the Middle East, they'd never had to deal with that. You know, there are strict laws, especially in Pakistan, where many of the first generation of immigrants came from, against blasphemy. They have very airtight blasphemy laws where you can't say anything about Islam or the Prophet Muhammad. You know, you go to prison or you can be executed. So when this book was published, it caused a lot of anger. People didn't know how to react to it, and it was felt like an assault on their faith. And there were huge protests against it, and it elicited a very aggressive reaction. And of course, Ayatollah Khomeini did his famous speech calling for the death of Salman Rushdie and anyone involved with the book. interesting to know, and I learned this about a year ago. Does anybody know what date Rushdie did it? Ayatollah Khomeini did that speech on? 14th of February. Imagine getting that Valentine's Day card, you know? Awkward. Ooh, wasn't expecting that. So after that, you know, it became very aggressive, and there were protests calling for Rushdie's death, calling for the book to be banned. In hindsight, and these were happening in London, in Germany, in Italy, wherever, you know, wherever there were significant Muslim communities, these protests happened. But the strategy wasn't well thought out. In hindsight, it really wasn't well thought out, because here's the thing. The issue was the book was offensive, we wanted it banned, we didn't want, you know, the publishers or anybody making any profit from it, okay? Fine. So they went about it by having these huge protests, you know, ban the book, you know, death to Rushdie, and so on and so forth. But then people were going out and buying copies of Satanic Verses to burn it. So it made Rushdie millions, because you had thousands of people buying the book to burn the book. So it really wasn't a great strategy. Thankfully, it's not today, because could you imagine people buying e-books and burning their iPads, you know? Crazy. But after the whole Satanic Verses affair, things had changed. And it was basically you had external organizations, groups like Hizb ut-Tahrir, Al-Muhajirun, who were starting to now enter communities and try and push their kind of radical narrative. And they were going to Muslim communities. They were going, okay, you guys live in the West. You guys pray, you guys fast, you know, you teach your kids the Quran in Arabic. But what are you actually doing? What are you actually doing for your Muslim brothers and sisters who are dying in Chechnya, in Bosnia, in Palestine, in Kashmir? What are you actually doing? You know, all you're doing is the very basics. And it was also the start of what has become a really powerful technique for brainwashing people. And that was the use of very graphic images to elicit a real emotive reaction, to manipulate a person's way of thought. Because you have to think about it this way. If I, for example, projected an image here of a dead child and said, this child has been killed by so-and-so in this location, as a human being, as somebody with any degree of empathy, your first reaction isn't to question that image. You're not going to question, okay, is that authentic? Am I being lied to? Is that made up? You're going to be upset. You know, you're seeing a dead child. Your reaction is going to be emotional. And when you're then being directed to who is responsible and who you need to hate, and especially when it's made more significant to you, when it says, you know, these are your Muslim sisters in Palestine, your reaction is going to be fairly emotive. You're not going to step back and go, think rationally, it's going to normally create anger. And that was in the early 90s. I mean, now with social media, it's much more widespread. And you've seen in the last few conflicts Israel has been involved in, the use of images from the conflicts in Syria and Iraq, and basically packaged as this is what's happening in Gaza. So, you know, this was really gaining traction, and it wasn't really taken seriously, these radical organizations. The kind of community elders thought these are young people, they'll get over it, it will die out. It didn't, it became much stronger because they were talking the right language. They were appealing to certain demographics. They were appealing to young British Muslims who spoke English, who knew a bit about their religion, but wanted to know more, who didn't understand the religion their parents had come to the West with and felt disillusioned with society. You know, people from deprived areas. You know, it was very targeted. Again, for me, it wasn't priority. You know, I'm 13, 14, it's again background noise. What changed for me, why I embraced radicalism, it started by visiting Pakistan. I went to Pakistan in 2000 to visit family, nothing else. It was a very kind of conventional thing. And where we are from in Pakistan is exceptionally boring. I can't emphasize this. It is one of the most boring places on the planet. There are mountains and dust. And then if you're really lucky, there's more mountains and dust. It's not like a Karachi or an Islamabad where there's hub and activity. It's very boring, up in the mountains. And for the first time in my life, I was confronted by this idea of violent extremism being used to achieve religious and political goals, you know, or as some would say, a violent jihad. And it came in the form of an organization called Lashkar-e-Taiba. Lashkar-e-Taiba are a Pakistani-based terrorist group. Their name loosely translates to Army of the Pure, and they were responsible for the Mumbai attacks in India many years ago. And everywhere I went, their flags were flying, there were posters glorifying them, they had people recruiting from town squares for this great jihad against India, which is one of their main targets. And it was using very emotive language, very evocative images, and I remember one in particular. There was this huge painting on the side of a mountain, and it had, in Urdu, destroy those who oppose Islam. It had an image of an AK-47 assault rifle, and it had the flags of America, of Israel, and India on fire. Now, if you look at that rationally, okay, at 17 years old, you look at this, you'd think, these guys are quite obviously bonkers. Obviously. But here's the issue. For me, I'm not looking at it rationally, because in the background, whether I realized it or not, I've been told that Israel and the Jews are evil. I've been told that America is evil. I've been told that India is murdering people. I've seen all these really emotive and evocative images. And one of the most interesting things, and it's something I've really been kind of giving a lot of thought to recently, is how radical groups disillusion young youth, how they basically make them into victims when they're not. As a British Muslim, I had complete freedom to practice my religion. I had complete freedom to not practice my religion. You know, we had a fairly good healthcare system, a great education system, and all these things. But these groups feed it into your head that because you are a Muslim, you're oppressed by society. Because you're a Muslim, the West is at war with your faith, and you are a victim. And, you know, when it's repeated over and over again, it does have an effect. You feel helpless. So when you see images like this, which are glorifying violence against the West, you kind of think, okay, it's not great, but these guys are doing something. They're refusing to be victims. And it is very appealing, especially when you're 17, 18, and you've been made to feel helpless constantly with all these images of death and destruction and how the Muslim world is so weak and being oppressed and so on and so forth. So I came back to the UK and started looking more into Lashkar-e-Taiba. And they follow a particular stream of Islam, which is very radical and very extreme, and is basically the same theological Islam that groups like ISIS follow. And it's very dogmatic, it's very black and white, it's very us versus them, it doesn't tolerate any difference, it's very much a totalitarian system of religious supremacism. But it made sense because they package it really smartly. They go, here are all the ills of the world, here are all the problems, here are all the issues that the Muslims are suffering. What we need to do is go backwards. We need to go back to when Islam was stronger, and the only way to do that is to go back theologically. We need to go back to the 7th century. So all the developments which have happened with religion, we need to throw those away because they have weakened us. So, you know, it kind of strikes a chord. And the other thing is, all of these groups, be it Lashkar-e-Taiba, be it ISIS, be it Hezbollah, whoever, everything converges to the central point of anti-Semitism. It is such a huge factor, you know, that everything, all the ills of the world, the Jews are responsible for, and Israel is the very personification of world Jewry. So you kind of get sucked into it, and the more speeches you hear, the more books you read, and here's the interesting thing, okay? The internet is a crazy place. There's all sorts of weird and wonderful things on the internet. But it was the books I was able to buy openly in the UK, which is more troubling. I was able to buy books by Sheikh Abdullah Azam translated into English, who was Osama bin Laden's mentor in Afghanistan. I was able to buy DVDs which were produced by Al-Qaeda and translated into English. I was able to buy books by very extreme scholars, speeches by very extreme speakers, you know, who were advocating terrorism, who are advocating for violence, and these are readily available. And there's one book which is still available, I've seen in the same book I bought over a decade ago, called The Antichrist, The Jewish King, and it's still on sale at the same bookstore. I used to, a few years ago when I traveled, I would bring these with me, but after a bit of an unfortunate incident when the TSA opened my case and found, you know, the assorted works of bin Laden, I just thought, I'm not doing that again. So, you know, you'll have to use your imagination. So, you know, there was so much information and so much kind of propaganda that you could kind of pick up. It was very easy to become radicalized. But the two things that had a huge effect on me, the two things that took me from being an adherent of a very radical stream of thought to becoming an actual activist and, you know, a real extremist, the first was September 11th, and obviously we're very close to that date now. and in the city, it does have relevance. When September the 11th happened, I really didn't know where I stood. Because here was the issue. On the one hand, it's this awful act of terrorism. I didn't see it as terrorism at the time, but it's, you know, 3,000, 4,000 people have been murdered. But on the other hand, you switch to the radical victim mentality and think, well, you know what, they maybe deserved it. For everything they do in the Middle East and the policies America pursues, maybe they kind of deserved it. And it was also the voices which were coming out in semi-condemnation of it from certain sections of the Muslim community. There were three main voices which emerged. The first one was those like Anjum Chowdhury, the real extremist nutters, who went, this is great, this is brilliant. And on the other side of the spectrum, you had those who were very rational and very clear and went, this is awful, this is disgusting, it has nothing to do with religion. Straight away, outright condemnation and nothing else. But the most widespread kind of opinion was this. This is an awful act of terrorism, it has nothing to do with religion, but when you look at America's foreign policy, you can understand why it happened. This strange justifying of the murder of innocent people on foreign policy. And it's really interesting, I think maybe it's a Western thing we do, that when we're attacked by terrorists, we feel we have to apologize. What did we do to make you want to kill us? You know, could we have made it easier for you to kill us? It's this really strange kind of attitude we have. And it became really prevalent after September the 11th because here you had the United States attacked by terrorists. And, you know, you couldn't make the arguments of these people being, you know, deprived and so because many were from Saudi Arabia, one of the richest countries in the world. And the focus instantly turned onto America. What is America doing? And from that, it was then put onto Israel, America's support of the State of Israel. After 9/11, I became very involved in the anti-war movement, which quickly turned into an anti-Israel movement. Israel became the focus. And also at the same time, 2001, the Second Intifada was happening. And I found that many clerics who had condemned 9/11 to some degree, people who I saw as moderates who I didn't recognize as being true Muslims, weren't condemning terrorism against Israel. They were, in some respects, justifying it. They were making excuses for suicide bombings in Tel Aviv or Jerusalem. And for me, you know, being at that age, being, you know, embracing a very radical theology, it was almost like, okay, you know, this issue crosses the sectarian divide where everybody accepts that Israel is this evil nation and attacking, killing their civilians, it's fine. But the single most radicalizing factor for me, actually, let me just go back as well. Also, around 9/11, you had the crazy conspiracy theories, which still are prevalent. You know, somebody I know who became a lecturer in law, a law lecturer for many years, he, probably to this day, actually, I've not spoken to him for a number of years, he resolutely believes that on September the 11th, 2001, there were no Jews in New York. Really, he believes that September 11th, 2001, there were no Jews in New York. I mean, I've spent a few hours walking around New York. I mean, no Jews in New York. It's going to be a quiet day. Come on, let's be honest. You know, not to be that guy, but it's going to be a pretty quiet day. But, you know, he really believes this. It's these crazy conspiracy theories which people believe. So after September the 11th, the most single defining, radicalizing aspect of my life was going to university. I went to a British university. I didn't go to Cairo or Damascus, I went to a British university. And from day one, you are bombarded with this anti-Israel message. I'll give you an example. The very first day I was at university, the Islamic Society at the time decided to play a video, do an event called How to Be a Better Muslim. I'm a pretty good Muslim, but there's always room for improvement. I'll give this a whirl. So I go to this event and we played a video. For 20 minutes, we played this video with very graphic images of violence. You know, Israeli soldiers at checkpoints, people with limbs missing, very graphic violence. No narration over this video at all, not a single word. And it ends with the caption, "What are you doing for your brothers and sisters in Palestine?" Okay, so I watch this and think, okay, I know this already, but a lot of people, this may be new and they'll need some context. Right after the event, word for word, the head of the society switches off the video and goes, "For those interested in joining the society, there are forms at the back," and walks off. So you've been bombarded with all these images, no context, and left for that to kind of stew with that end caption. Now, you could say that doesn't affect anybody. You know, people aren't that gullible. I can give you an example. My cousin was studying at the same university a few years ago, okay? No interest in politics, legitimately no interest in politics, no real interest in religion, no interest in the Middle East at all. So one evening, she knocks on my door. I answer, she's really red-faced and goes, "Why are your people killing my people?" That means we're first cousins. We're kind of like the same people. What are you talking about? She went, "No, no, why are the Jews killing Muslims?" Which one am I in this scenario? I'm not really too sure. She went, "No, no, no, why..." Oh, look, okay, seriously, stop. You're doing my head in, come in. She went, "No, why are the Israelis doing what they're doing to the Palestinians?" I'm, "What are you talking about? Well, where's this coming from?" She went, "Well, I went to the Islamic Society and we watched this video." I went, "Okay, stop. Come in and let me make a cup of tea and let's discuss this." I'm very British. You have a crisis, you make a cup of tea, you know? Actually, I'll tell you a secret, and I probably shouldn't say this on camera, but I'm gonna, and you know, I apologize to my country. The only reason, and this is a state secret, the only reason you guys won the War of Independence, the moment you start throwing perfectly good tea into Boston Harbor, we just didn't know what to do with you guys. We thought, okay, there is no rationalizing with this people, there's no civilizing this people, we're off, we're done, too far. So, true story. But anyway, after I made a cup of tea, I spoke to my cousin, I explained, and yeah, we had this really long conversation, and she kind of understood it a bit more. She then went to the opposite side of the spectrum, and I was like, no, don't start hating the other side, that's not what this is about. But 20-minute video had influenced her so much that she felt the need to knock on my door and attack me for my views. So it is very dangerous when people aren't given any context. It's, you know, it's brainwashing, essentially. While I was in university, I became very active. You know, I was handing out leaflets, Israel is an apartheid state, Israel is killing babies, Israel is eating polar bears, all these kind of crazy things. You know, I was going to events by very radical speakers. You had these kind of, these guys who are anti-Semites, essentially, coming to university and speaking. In London, there's an event called the Al-Quds Day Rally. It's basically an Iranian government-sponsored hate fest. In the center of London, happens every year. I believe it's starting to happen in other countries as well. I think it was in Toronto recently as well. And basically, you have certain British MPs, who I don't have to name, who will say Israel is evil, Israel is a cancer. You have people in the center of London waving Hamas and Hezbollah flags. They're terrorist organizations. You have tiny children, 6 years old, holding up signs saying Israel is a cancer. I mean, it's awful. Or a great family day out, depending on who you are, you know. But you know, this is happening in the center of London, so I'm going to these events. And one of the keystones of the anti-Israel movement, because I sincerely believe, and I say anti-Israel movement because I believe it is an anti-Israel movement, I do not believe that anything resembling a pro-Palestinian movement exists in the Western world. Especially not in the Arab world. Because if it really did, why are they not speaking out against Hamas's use of human shields? Hamas spending millions, if not billions of dollars on building tunnels underground for terrorism, but not looking after their own people. Why are they not speaking out against honor killings? Why are they not speaking out against, you know, the summary execution of people in Gaza and the West Bank? There's a complete silence on that. But when it comes to Israel, you know, Israel apartheid week and Israel this week, it's an anti-Israel movement. You know, in all my times as, you know, a Palestinian activist, did nothing for the Palestinians other than wave a flag occasionally. Everything was attacking Israel. And the other thing is, you know, one of the pillars of it is fear and intimidation. It's to intimidate people. It's to be aggressive. It's to show that, you know, we're right and we don't care. The truth doesn't matter. Because, you know, I studied politics at university, and within lectures, whatever we were talking about, we could be talking about conservation in the rainforest. Somehow we would bring Israel into it, how Israel was evil, and how Israel was the cause of global warming. You know, you would somehow bring Israel into it. Because it served two objectives. Firstly, you're getting this message out there that Israel is bad. Secondly, it's to kind of set a marker. You know, we were quite scary. You know, back in the day, and I can show you a picture later if you want, I used to have a big beard and long hair. I had a whole ZZ Top thing going on. But, you know, quite scary. So you'd understand why a small minority of Jewish students who are at the university wouldn't speak up. But you're setting a marker there that, you know, this is what we believe, we're aggressive in it, and we're going to keep saying it. And if you don't respond, it's seen as a victory. outside of the lecture hall, you can make more anti-Semitic comments. You can be a lot more aggressive and so on and so forth. And here's the thing. Look, I'm not proud of this, but I was anti-Semitic. But unless you're a Hungarian politician, it's not a very cool thing in Europe. Nobody got the European joke there. US audiences. But seriously, I was anti-Semitic. But here's the thing. It's not popular, so you repackage it. And people don't agree with me on this point, but I don't care, to be honest, because I think I'm right. It sounds really arrogant, but I sincerely think I'm right. Anti-Zionism is anti-Semitism. I don't believe they're two different things, because simply, anti-Semitism is hatred of Jews, okay? Hatred of Jews, and that hatred is, you know, discrimination, bigotry, singling them out, and denying them rights that you don't deny any other group. Zionism, by its nature, is a movement for the liberation of Jews, for them to have sovereignty, freedom, to basically determine their own destiny and future, like every other people. Similar to the Pakistan movement from India. You know, the Pakistan wanted to be a separate country because they went, we don't want to be at the mercy of a majority whose religion and customs are different, so we want to determine our own future. So to be anti-Zionist is basically to deny the Jews the rights you don't deny anybody else. To deny them sovereignty, to deny them freedom, to deny them the right to determine their own future by their own laws and customs. So that's discrimination and bigotry against one group, the Jews. So it's racism. So when it's racism against the Jews, it's kind of anti-Semitism. I just don't understand how this language is still seen as acceptable to say I'm an anti-Zionist and people are cool with it. The mind boggles. I really don't understand it. But I got to a point on campus in my activism where I thought, I asked myself the question radical Islam asked me many, many years ago when I was tiny. What are you actually doing? I thought, not enough. And one thing I'd learned over the last 5 years was that one thing that does work, better or worse, is violence. Be it suicide bombings in Israel, be it 9/11, be it the Madrid bombings, it focuses the world's attention. It makes a statement. So I started saving. I thought I'll go back to Pakistan, I'll go to one of these jihadist training camps, it won't be difficult to find, and we'll take it from there. Thankfully that didn't happen. Well, this could be even more awkward than when we started. And what changed, it wasn't anything spectacular. It wasn't, you know, this kind of epiphany out of the blue. I was in a bookshop and I saw this book, The Case for Israel. Now, two things. One, I thought I was an expert in the Middle East at this point. Two, for me, Israel, Zionism equated Nazism and fascism. So for somebody to write a book called The Case for Israel, I thought this is ludicrous. But I'm gonna buy this book. And because Zionism is so full of lies, I'll be able to disprove it, and you know, it'll be a small victory. So I start reading it, and Alan Dershowitz makes some absolutely ludicrous claims. He goes, the Jewish people have had a presence in the Holy Land for thousands of years. You know, for over 2,000 years, you know. Before that, the Jews have had a presence in the Holy Land. I was like, no. It's obviously not true. We all seen the maps. The Jews came from Europe post-Holocaust, Holocaust guilt, and stole the land. Alan Dershowitz is a huge supporter of the two-state solution, but he goes, look, a Palestinian state has never existed. You know, it's never existed. It's like, no. Look, we all know there was a Palestinian state, the Jews came, stole the land, genocide, apartheid, so forth, and so on. And he talks about 1967, he talks about Israel as a democracy, Israel trying to make peace with their neighbors, its multi-ethnic society, the rights of minorities, all these things which were completely alien to me. And recently I've been thinking about certain things I believed. Like my narrative on Israel's War of Independence was this. And when you say it out loud, you think, man, I was stupid. Like really? Because my narrative was this, that in 1948, the state of Israel comes into existence, okay? This tiny country which is struggling to get weapons. They were buying weapons from Czechoslovakia. Who buys anything from Czechoslovakia? Have you ever bought a car and gone, ah, that's quality, that is, from Czechoslovakia? You know, so they're trying to buy weapons from anyone who will sell them. And it's this tiny country made up of kibbutzniks who are tilling the land and Holocaust survivors. So they get independence, just, it's tiny, and they decide that what we're going to now do is attack the five Arab armies that surround us, because that's a really good idea. But that's what I believed, and when you think, I was really stupid, like really, like not even like a bit stupid, like really stupid. And all these kind of strange things you believe. So read this book and thought, okay, these are all lies. I'm now going to disprove it. Really ironic, somebody who was planning on blowing themselves up saying I was stupid because I believed a lie, really. It's ironic in itself. So I thought I'll disprove it. And I read the book, which was the direct reply to the case for Israel. And it didn't really make any valid arguments. It used a lot of kind of rhetoric and these emotive arguments. But one thing about the case for Israel, it is, do I say this on camera? It's very boring. Okay, it's very boring, but it's amazingly well-written and amazingly factual. And for me, at that stage in my life, following a very dogmatic ideology, the way the case for Israel really appealed to me, how it was written. You know, everything was sourced from UN documents, from historical documents. So he made some very strong arguments. So to disprove it, I needed something similar. Wasn't finding it. I thought this should only take a few weeks. What was meant to take a few weeks ended up being 2 years. For 2 years, I obsessively read everything about Israel, the Middle East, you know, the Palestinian territories that I could. And people will say that's excessive. You know, 2 years is a long time. But my hatred of Israel was so obsessive, it was an obsession that I couldn't accept that on the one hand, here's what I believe and I'm ready to die for. On the other hand, everything I'm reading is not validating my point of view. And I kind of found out that it's very difficult to disprove the truth. Not impossible, politicians do it all the time, but it's very difficult. So my life had gone through kind of a real up and down because of it. You know, friends had kind of backed off, they thought I was, you know, turning Jewish or something. And I kind of suffered from this period of depression because I couldn't reconcile these two things because it was such a deeply held conviction. So I thought, okay, I need to get some closure on this. So what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna go to Israel, see it for what it is, this awful apartheid state. Now, I'll hopefully land in Israel, be beaten up by 6 security guards because I'm Muslim. Again, you know, life goes on. So I, ironically, and again, this is something I realized recently. I thought, okay, look, you were working one day a week. You were a university student. How did you afford a flight to Israel? Oh, you were saving to go to Pakistan to a jihadist training camp. So I gave that money to El Al instead, you know. So I flew from London Heathrow to Ben Gurion in Tel Aviv and spent 8 hours in security. Not a bad experience. Honestly, 8 hours is a long time. But it wasn't a bad experience, and I'll explain why. Secondly, kind of my own fault. Here's the thing. I realized I didn't know that much about Israel. So I bought one of these Lonely Planet guides to Israel. I'm reading it, and it's these blue boxes with the important information. It says, Israelis are exceptionally security conscious. So if you're doing nothing nefarious, just be honest. Fine. I get to passport control, I hand over my passport, and you know, you get the Israelis, you know, what is the purpose of your visit to Israel? Well, I used to be anti-Semitic and anti-Israel. Now I'm not too sure, so I thought I'd come and see it for myself. Being honest. So you're going to have to take a seat, and somebody will be with you shortly. Take a seat, and eventually the guy from security comes, Hafeez, yes, and going back and forth, he goes, look, what you're telling us is very strange. You realize that, right? Well, no, it can't be that strange. He goes, look, just trust me, it is. And at the same time, he's constantly apologizing. You know, in Israel, things are not so good, you know? So we're very sorry, and we'll try and get you on your way as quick as possible. And, you know, we're covering all these points. Where did you grow up? Where are your family from? And all these things, going back and forth. And he says to me, you know, my passport was very new. It'd just been renewed a month before I came to Israel. And he goes, look, is this the first place you've traveled? Because if it is, that's very suspicious. So I went, no, look, of course, look at the date on it. It's April, it's July now, it's only been 2 months. He goes, so where have you traveled in the last 10 years? I went, well, I went to Pakistan. He goes, okay, why? I've got family there. He goes, okay, I can understand that. You've only been to Pakistan? Oh, I went to Saudi Arabia as well. Okay, I'll be right back, just don't worry. So, and here's the thing. Like I said, he was very polite, he was very apologetic. He explained, look, this is the situation in Israel, you've got to, you know, we apologize, but we have to be careful. And I look at Saudi Arabia. When I went to Saudi Arabia, to this day, okay, and I've been to parts of Eastern Europe, which have got quite a reputation for racism and bigotry. To this day, I've never experienced the level of racism, witnessed racism, seen religious bigotry like Saudi Arabia anywhere in the world. I've never seen anything to that level, so open, so blatant, and so unashamed. So here I am in apartheid Israel, And this guy's been very apologetic. He's, you know, constantly apologizing. He's being quite respectful. And then he turns Jewish mother on me. He goes, would you like a coffee? No, I'm good. No, you've been here a few hours. Let me get you a coffee. Honestly, I appreciate the thought, but I'm good. I'm fine. He goes, come on, you know, you're going to be tired. You need a coffee. Honestly, I'm good. Look, I'll get you a coffee. No, honestly, I really appreciate it. Thank you so much, but I'm good. Okay, fine. I'll get you a coffee anyway. And he goes and gets me a coffee. He does this about 8 or 9 times. But eventually he goes, okay, fine, everything checks out. You know, I'm quite confident that you're not going to go boom in the center of Tel Aviv. I'm going to let you go. He didn't say that, but, you know, I'm guessing that's what the sentiments. Yeah. So if this guy's stupid enough to say that he was an anti-Semite to an Israeli immigration officer, we've got nothing to fear. He's handing me my passport. He goes, look, can I give you some advice? I thought, okay, of course. You know, we've spoken for 8 hours. We've literally covered from the moment I was born up until my point here at Ben-Gurion Airport. What he could say now will fundamentally change how I see Israel. So I go, of course. He goes, look, the next time you come to Israel, just say you're here for a holiday. It would just be so much quicker for everybody. Okay, fair enough. Not life-changing, but hey, you know, advice is advice. So I go from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem and check into the hotel, do all the regular stuff. And then I think, okay, let me see Israel. Let's see apartheid Israel. So when you talk about apartheid, South Africa obviously is the real example. I was in South Africa not long ago and, you know, went to the apartheid museum and I was looking for the Arab-only bus stops and the Arab-only stores and all these kind of, you know, telltale signs. And you don't see that, you see the opposite. And one of the interesting things, my last visit to Israel in February, I took this picture and it's amazing. It's a brilliant picture. For me, it typifies Israel. So I'm walking down Jaffa Street and I see, you know, the Jaffa Street, the tram stop, and I look across and it is the best group of people I've ever seen. And I'm willing to bet every single cent that I have owned, will own, that you will never find this group of people anywhere else on the planet. Okay? There's a soldier, a Muslim woman with a headscarf on, a Greek Orthodox priest, an Orthodox Jewish guy, and this dude with green hair. There is nowhere else on the planet of 6 billion people those people will be at the same place at the same time. It's like the start of a joke. But, you know, that's Israel. But on my first visit, you know, I started speaking to people. You know, I saw this young couple in the market near the old city and, you know, being very British, I went, you know, these guys are Muslim. Assalamu alaikum. The guy replies, wa alaikum salam. It's like, result, he's Muslim. And then I do possibly one of the most embarrassing things I've ever done. It's almost Mr. Bean-esque in how embarrassing it is. I go, it must be so difficult for you here. He looks at me in pretty clear English and goes, what are you talking about? But okay, this guy obviously hasn't understood what I just said. I go, okay. It must be so difficult for you here living in Israel. At this point, he's literally like pushing his wife and kid back, kind of save yourself. And he goes, no, really, what are you talking about? I went, look, you live here. And I launched into this pre-rehearsed speech about how it's awful and, you know, the Jews treat you. He went, look, okay, calm down. He went, firstly, me as a minority, are things perfect for me here in Israel? No. But are things perfect for you as a minority in your country? I thought, okay, dude, we're not talking about my country right now, you know, it's about Israel. He goes, look, this isn't a bad place to live. And, you know, my kid has education here, we have great healthcare, it's a great place to live, and where else in this region do you want me to go? There's nowhere better than this place in this region. If you don't recognize that, then that's your issue. I thought, okay, look, this guy looks like he's 25, 26, he's obviously lived here his whole life, he's brainwashed, you know? I've been here 2 hours, he doesn't know what he's talking about. So I kind of speak to other people, and I mean, I met Christians, I met Jews, I met Muslims, I met people of no religion, I met a Druze. I mean, you know, I'm from Nottingham, I don't know what a Druze is. You know, I thought it was something on Doctor Who or something, you know, it was crazy. But to this day, I mean, that was 7 years ago, I've never heard anybody speak as passionately about Israel as this Druze guy. Because he was like, look, you know, the Druze have been the stray dog in the Middle East. Wherever we've gone, we've been kicked and abused. In Israel, we have a home. You know, I fought in the IDF, my son fought in the IDF, my grandson, well, this is our home and we will die defending it. And I thought, okay, well, that was unexpected. So it's been a pretty heavy day. So I thought, okay, it's time to be a tourist. I go to the old city, I go to the mosque, I go to the church, and then I think, do I go to the Western Wall? I'm not Jewish. My experience is in Saudi Arabia, firstly. You know, non-Muslims aren't allowed into the holy cities at all. But also, there's another level of religious discrimination when, if you're not the right kind of Muslim, you're going to probably find yourself arrested by the religious police for doing something the Saudi authorities don't believe is authentic Islam. So I think, look, I'm never going to come back here. I'll give it a whirl. So I go straight through the security point. No issues, you know, I've got no metal on me. And I walk in towards the Western Wall thinking, oh my God, what am I meant to do here? Do I pray? Do I rub the stones? I have no idea. So 2007, they still had the kippahs made out of cardboard. Now they're fabric, it's like real, they've got an upgrade. I actually stole one last time, I'm not gonna lie. Wanted a souvenir, and then felt really guilty and went back and made a donation. But you know, they were cardboard in 2007, so I put one on and I'm walking towards the wall thinking, okay, what do we do here? And then look, this young British Muslim, taking a lot in, really having doubts about what's going on right now. The last thing you need to see as you're walking to one of the holiest sites in Judaism is the Chabad guy with tefillin. Because I thought, I don't know what this dude is selling, but I really am not interested. So I'm like, oh, I'm good, bro. So it's good. Thanks, I'll pass, maybe next time. So I kind of head down, walk past him. And I'm right at the wall. I'm thinking, okay, now what? And something I realized as I've got older, if you're in a situation and not sure what to do, you feel a bit awkward, copy the person next to you. This guy had his arm on the wall. I thought, I can do that, simple enough. And I've told this story a lot of times, and you know, the next part does sound a bit cliche, sometimes it sounds cheesy, but this is the reality of what happened. Eventually, my forehead's against the wall. And I'm thinking, it's kind of the first time in a number of years I was able to kind of think clearly. I was able to kind of process all these thoughts without the kind of background noise. And I thought, okay, here I am in the state of Israel, the world's only Jewish state. I've met people of all races, religions, colors, you know, all over the place. This is a democracy. You know, they value human rights and freedom, and I'm seeing that in practice. I've met people who are just trying to get on with their life, people who have a genuine desire for peace and to be left alone and nothing else. And here I am at one of the holiest sites in Judaism. I have the blue and white of Israel behind me, the white with the blue Star of David. And here's a country I hated, passionately hated and wanted to destroy. These are people I wanted to see murdered, you know, man, woman, and child. And I thought, how wrong could I have been? And then what really clicked for me was this, that here I am in Jerusalem, the center of the Jewish world for thousands of years. No matter what will happen from this point on, no matter what wars will happen, no matter what peace treaties, acts of terrorism, whatever, there are 6 million who won't ever live to see this. There are 6 million who died in my continent, in Europe, who died with this idea of next year in Jerusalem. And they will never see this. And that's when it really hit home that Israel isn't about politics. It's not even about conflict. It's about survival. It's about having a home for the Jewish people. It's about the continuation of possibly the greatest story in history. And Israel isn't a result of the Holocaust. It could have been, it would have been, the safe haven which prevented the Holocaust. Because we talk about in North America about human rights and values, and I live in Canada, and we really champion freedom and human rights, we really do. But when things were bad in Europe, when the Jews needed an out, Canada, like most of the Western world, at Evian said, sorry, we can't really take you. You know, we'd love to help, but we've got enough Jews as it is. And you know, there are stories of ships leaving, you know, going for days, weeks to North America and being sent back to Nazi Germany. Israel would never do that. Israel is that home where no matter what, when the Jewish people are under threat, they will go, do you know what? Come home. And for me, what really also stood out was how can I, as a Pakistani, okay, somebody whose grandparents and great-grandparents fought for an independent Pakistan, so they were not at the mercy of a majority, a Hindu majority, so they could live by their own customs and everything, how much of a hypocrite am I to now deny the Jewish people the same right to sovereignty? In a land, they've had a presence not only before the first Muslim set foot in the Asian subcontinent, before the first Muslim set foot on Earth. How much of a hypocrite can I be? And it was at that point I really understood that I was wrong. I accepted that, okay, I've got this really, really wrong. But I had to understand it more. You know, it wasn't just I've got it wrong and that's it. I had to understand Israel. I had to understand Zionism. I had to understand the region more, away from the books. So I spent 2.5 weeks traveling around Israel. I went to Judea and Samaria and spoke to people, went to museums, really kind of immersed myself in it with an open mind. As I was getting ready to go back to the UK, I thought, where do we go from here? Do we say, it was a great trip, I bought some awful souvenirs and life goes on? Or do I go, it was a great trip, I bought some awful souvenirs, but now I speak out against this because this is wrong. These lies are wrong, this demonization is wrong, this vilification is wrong, this singling out of the world's only Jewish state for boycotts, divestments, and all these kind of words of apartheid, genocide, and all these things are lies that are poisoning people. And for me, it was always the second choice, because it matters, because it's the right thing to do, because it's the moral thing to do. And even now, look, it's been tough. I'm not going to lie. I'm not going to say it's been easy. You know, most of my family don't talk to me. You know, there's like an official boycott from the family, which I find ironic, you know, BDS, really. And all these things, you know, I get death threats from people who can't spell properly. I get all sorts of strange things. But I do not regret a single second of what I've done since, because what Israel represents is a real hope and a light in a very dark region. In a region where human rights abuses, where racism, where people are slaughtered for being different, Israel is the home of hope. Israel represents the right to be different in the Middle East. You don't have to be a Sunni Muslim to live a free and open life. You don't have to be dogmatically on one way to live a free and open life. You can exist as who you are, be it Christian, be it Shia, be it Muslim, be it Ahmadiyya, be it Druze. You have freedom. And also, if you look at what Israel has achieved in such a short span of time, no other country at that size, at that length of time, has changed the world so dramatically as Israel. Be it technology, be it healthcare, be it humanitarian work. Per capita, there is no other country which impacts the world like Israel. And all I can ask you guys is this. Really, when it comes down to it, it's not about me. Really, I really appreciate you guys coming out and hearing me speak, but it's not about me. You know, my story is, you know, on the whole, irrelevant. What matters now is what you do from here on. Israel gets such a bad rap, be it in the media, be it on college campuses, be it just in general conversation with people. It's, you know, so much hatred and lies are directed at it. What do you do? Do you stay silent and pretend it's not happening? That's what we did in Europe. In the UK, we went, it's not happening, it will go away, and it's not. And anti-Semitism is once again rampant in the UK. You have Jews who are afraid to wear skull caps. You have Jews who are afraid to express any notion of their Jewish identity. You have Jews who are afraid to wave the Israeli flag. Don't let that happen here. Because what America represents, the values of freedom, you know, that people have a right to be free, those freedoms didn't appear overnight. They didn't appear, you know, just as some miracle. People fought for them. People died for them. Don't allow yourself to surrender those freedoms willingly. Because if tomorrow your kids or your grandkids are afraid to express their identity, are afraid to stand up for Israel, the Middle East's only true democracy, the Middle East's only true friend to Western democracies, you'll have no one to blame but yourselves if you don't do anything. So that's all I'm asking. If it's having a conversation with somebody about Israel, if it's wearing a pin with the Israeli flag on to start a conversation, be proud of who you are, be proud of what you represent, and never ever let anybody take that away from you. Because for supporting Israel, you should never be ashamed, because it is a moral cause, it's a righteous cause, and it truly is one of the most important causes we're dealing with as we go into the next decade. So I'm just going to finish with thank you so much. God bless America. Am Israel Chai. Thank you very much. Okay, so you're asking, where are the origins of this deep-rooted anti-Semitism? Yeah, of course, it's not nothing to do, well, I say nothing, but it's intensified with the creation of the State of Israel. A lot of it comes, honestly, it comes from religion. You know, anti-Semitism isn't core to Islam, but there are aspects within religious texts which do, you know, can be interpreted and point to anti-Semitic ideas. They're definitely there, and they've developed over time, and after the, or during even the Second World War, you know, a lot of kind of the Nazis escaped to places like Egypt and Syria, and so you had what you'd probably class as classic Islamic anti-Semitism, then infused with Nazi anti-Semitism, and now it's become a completely different creature. And one, it's widespread financially, because, you know, in Pakistan, you know, Pakistan's not exactly known for its huge Jewish population, is it? You know, there are no Jews there, but there's such a high level of anti-Semitism. And it comes through the education system, which has been filtered through different Arab states. And now, with anti-Semitism, well, it's changing now, but anti-Semitism in Europe for a long time was unacceptable. I don't think, and I might be wrong, but this is just a theory, I don't think that anti-Semitism ever disappeared from Europe, truly. I just think with the Holocaust, it became such an abhorrent thing, it kind of went underground. What I believe is with the new wave of immigration that have come into Europe, you had people who weren't Aryan, who weren't blonde hair, blue eyes, you know, but people who were Middle Eastern, who were foreign, essentially, who were re-kind of injecting this old anti-Semitism, and it became okay. It became okay again. So you're now seeing that form of anti-Semitism, but you're also seeing the rise of classic European anti-Semitism rising again. But it is. A lot of it stems from religious ideas, which have been particularly highlighted. Some of it then stems from cultural issues from that time in Arabia, because there were Jewish populations in Arabia, and because they prospered, people develop these conspiracy theories. You know, if somebody's doing well, they must be doing something, you know, untoward. And then injected with Nazi anti-Semitism and the rise of Arab nationalism, which then turned into Islamism, it's just given it more strength and more momentum. And now the ideas are so widespread because they've literally, you know, you've got to realize, and I always give this example, the people who committed the worst crimes during the Holocaust weren't idiots. You had doctors, judges, lawyers, but they'd let the propaganda infect their brain. And they were willing to believe anything to the extent they were willing to murder babies simply because they were Jewish. In the Islamic world, that propaganda's been going on a lot, lot, lot longer. And it's continually renewed and continually reinfused. Now they just have a central point to focus on, and that's Israel. And that's kind of the sad thing, and it's been repackaged now as anti-Zionism. It's an acceptable term. How impactful is the moderate Muslim community globally? Not at all. We were talking about this earlier, but they're not very well organized. So the way I see it, and look, I sincerely believe that most Muslims, majority, be it 70%, be it 60%, whatever figure you want to put on it, are moderate, we're just trying to get on with life. Two issues. Firstly, when you've got a global population of 1.6 billion, 30% is still a ridiculously high number. The other thing is, they've become, in many ways, insignificant because we're not doing enough. We're not speaking out. And if as a community in general, we were very kind of placid and didn't speak out, it'd be one thing. But whenever there's a certain issue, you have millions on the street. But while, you know, ISIS are murdering people in Iraq and terrorism is happening and we say this isn't our faith, then we do nothing about it. It doesn't help. You know, actions speak louder than words, and if we're not doing anything, we're making ourselves insignificant in many ways. You know, there are people who are standing up. There's Dr. Zahoudi Jasser. You know, you've got Rahil Raza in Canada, people like that. But still, it's not well organized. There's not enough people standing up. And also, it's very difficult to compete with the organizations that, you know, radical Islam has. They're well organized. They have these huge budgets because of the countries they're funded by. And they've been smart. It's literally evil genius smart, where instead of targeting the older generation where they knew they were going to get no traction, these people who come from Pakistan and India, whose Islam is very tolerant, it's very much an Indian-Pakistani Islam, you know, which incorporates music and colors and all these things, they knew there was no point there. So they targeted the younger generation 10, 15 years ago, and now they're the adults of today, and they're the kind of adults who are then going off to join ISIS. And that's the thing. And the general Muslim community was so slow to recognize that. And even now, I don't think that most Muslims really know what to do, how to combat it. They really don't. And it's going to be the biggest challenge. Islam is at war with itself. You know, within Sunni Islam, Shia Islam not so much, but there is the Sunni-Shia divide, which will always be there. But within Sunni Islam, which covers such a wide spectrum of belief, from the most dogmatic, you know, Salafi beliefs to the most open and tolerant Sufi beliefs, they all come under this banner of Sunni Islam, and it is essentially at war with itself. And the scary thing is, to be honest, the radicals are winning. And, you know, we've kind of sleepwalked into this disaster. And if we don't do something to turn the tide now, and it has to come from the Islamic world, it has to come from Muslim communities, 10 to 15 years down the line, we're going to be in a worse situation than we are now. So I talked about human rights and, you know, what it was like in the West Bank and Gaza. It was different. Well, here's the thing. Look, nobody will say that the situation's perfect in either of those territories, okay? Because it isn't. But it shocked me how inflated some of the claims are. Like, look, I went to the West Bank, Judea, Samaria, whatever you want to call it, and there was very amazing buildings, you know, really nice buildings. The National Bank in Ramallah is this amazing glass building. You know, they talk about refugee camps, and some are, you know, well-built communities. And I'm not, like I said, it's not perfect. But then when I look at the situation in Pakistan, in 2000, you had refugees from 1947, Pakistan's independence, still living on the road in Karachi, literally in tents, not even real tents, like sticks with cloths over them. So the situation isn't perfect. But here's the thing. It doesn't mean that Israel is responsible for it. I know you've not said they were, but it doesn't mean Israel is responsible for that situation. You look at the money that UNRWA have been given, you look at the money which has gone into the Palestinian Authority, you look at the billions of dollars over, I think the Palestinian Authority has received more aid than all of Africa in the last 40, 50 years. Where did that money go? I mean, I remember this, an interview I watched on YouTube recently when Larry King interviewed Arafat, and he went to Yasser Arafat, he went, you know, you have a worth of, I don't know, it was something ridiculous, $100 million or something ridiculous. You know, that's how much you apparently have. How did you amass this wealth? And Arafat says to him completely straight-faced, he goes, don't you know, I'm an architect. No, an engineer, not an engineer. And Larry King just left it at that. Went, oh, okay, fair enough. Makes me kind of regret doing politics at university. But, you know, there's another thing. The situation isn't perfect, but the sad thing is that situation is constantly blamed on Israel. They're seen as being responsible for it. And personally, I don't believe that's true, because a lot of money's been pumped in. Even now, I mean, you look at the tunnels that Hamas built, you know? They're incredible structures. And that's money that should have been used to build infrastructure in the society in Gaza, not to lay down the foundations of terrorism. Good. Okay, thank you very much.
We would be pleased to send a complimentary DVD of this program to anyone who wishes to support Shalom TV with a tax-deductible gift of $36, double high or more, to the nonprofit organization Jewish Education in Media. Simply visit the Shalom TV website homepage and click on the Donate button to make a donation by PayPal or your credit card. And please indicate the program for which you would like a DVD. Or you can send your tax-deductible check made out to JEM, Post Office Box 180, Riverdale Station, Bronx, New York, 10471. And again, please remember to indicate which program you would like to receive on DVD with our compliments. And we thank you for your kind support.